Hello, Shabun is here, and Python programming lectures are wonderful. बहुत ही प्यारे lectures थे, मैंने पढ़ा उसको और उससे Python के जितने भी concept थे वो बहुत ही अच्छे से clear हो गए. और आजकल के trend में Python बहुत ही ruling है, मतलब हमें Python आनी चाहिए. ऐसा अगर being a CS student Python necessary हो चुकी है. तो वैसे तो अगर पाइथन नहीं करते तो बाहर से कहीं ना कहीं से हमें कोर्स करना ही पड़ता. बट अगर AKTU ने विद कानपुर IIT प्रोवाइड करा दिया है तो कोई प्रॉब्लम ही नहीं है. हमने एज यूजुअल कर लिया और इस लेक्चर से कॉन्सेप्ट क्लियर हो गए. प्रॉब्लम सॉल्विंग जो भी इन्होंने दी हुई थी इसमें वो बहुत ही ज्यादा क्लियर हो गई थी. मतलब अगर आपने वो लेक्चर्स एक बार कर लिए हैं और उसके बाद उसमें जो जो प्रॉब्लम्स है, क्योंकि वो बेसिक से उठा के एडवांस तक लेके गए हैं, तो अगर इनिशियल्स में कर दिए हैं तो एट द एंड में जाके आपको पाइथन की कोर पाइथन की तो अच्छे से नॉलेज हो जाएगी और बाकी सारी चीजें भी क्लियर हो जाएंगी. और उसके बाद जो वीकली असाइनमेंट आते हैं वो भी कम्प्लीट कर लिए, तो मतलब पाइथन कोर आपको अच्छे से आ जाएगी. आगे आप मशीन लर्निंग में अगर जाना चाहते हैं तो एडवांस पाइथन में बहुत हेल्प मिलेगी इसके लिए.
सर्टिफिकेशन का क्या फायदा है?
आगे बीइंग अ सेकंड ईयर स्टूडेंट्स सर्टिफिकेशन में हमें मिल रहा है. अगर हम बाहर से इनिशियली पाइथन का लिया था तो सिर्फ हम लेक्चर्स ही पढ़ रहे थे, तो लेक्चर्स बेनिफिशियल थे अनडाउटेबली, वो अच्छे हैं. लेकिन आगे पाइथन के वो हमें व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप में ज्वाइन किया गया, देन रिफ्रेशमेंट कोर्स मिले और स्टूडेंट्स से भी कांटेक्ट हुआ जो भी और कोर्सेज कर रहे हैं, तो उसकी वजह से मतलब अच्छा लगा कि ये सारी चीजें क्लियर हो गई आराम से. और जो स्टूडेंट्स से भी हम मिले और स्पेशली आपसे डायरेक्ट कॉन्टेक्ट हो गया जब हमने पेमेंट किया, तो क्योंकि जो भी क्वेरीज और क्वेश्चन थे वो हम डायरेक्ट आपसे पूछ सकते थे, तो ये ज्यादा अच्छा था.
Chapter 3. Introducing lists. In this chapter and the next, you will learn what lists are and how to start working with the elements in a list. Lists allow you to store sets of information in one place, whether you have just a few items or millions of items. Lists are one of Python's most powerful features, readily accessible to new programmers, and they tie together many important concepts in programming. So the question is, what is a list? A list is a collection of items in a particular order. You can make a list that includes the letters of the alphabet, the digits from 0 to 9, or the names of all the people in your family. You can put anything you want into a list, and the items in your list don't have to be related in any particular way. In Python, square brackets indicate a list and individual elements in the list are separated by commas. Here's a simple example of a list that contains a few kinds of colors. So colors is equal to blue, comma red, comma green, comma yellow. So we need to put these values or elements within square bracket. Now print colors. If you ask Python to print a list, Python returns its representation of the list, including the square brackets. Square bracket, blue, comma red, comma green, comma yellow, square bracket close. Because this isn't the output you want your users to see, let's learn how to access the individual items in a list. Accessing elements in a list. Lists are ordered collections. So you can access any element in a list by telling Python the position or index of the item desired. To access an element in a list, write the name of the list followed by the index of the item enclosed in a square brackets. For example, let's pull out the first color in the list of colors. So print colors within the square bracket 0. The syntax for this is shown at number 1. When we ask for a single item from a list, Python returns just that element without square brackets. So in this case, our output will be blue. This is the result you want your users to see, clean, neatly formatted output. You can also use the string methods from chapter 2 on any element in this list. For example, you can format the element blue more neatly by using title method. So we need to type in print colors 0.title. This example produces the same output as the preceding example, except blue is capitalized. Index positions start at 0, not 1. Python considers the first item in a list to be at position 0, not position 1. This is true of most programming languages, and the reason has to do with how the list operations are implemented at a lower level. The second item in a list has an index of 1. Using this counting system, you can get any element you want from a list by subtracting 1 from its position in the list. For example, to access the fourth item in a list, you request the item at index 3. The following asks for the color at index 1 and index 3. So print colors within square bracket 1, then print colors within square brackets 2. This code returns the second and fourth colors in the list. Red, green. Python has a special syntax for accessing the last element in a list. By asking for the item at index minus 1, Python always returns the last item in the list. So if we want to get the last element from our list, we need to type in print colors minus 1. Now this code returns the value yellow. The syntax is quite useful because you will often want to access the last items in a list without knowing exactly how long the list is. This convention extends to other negative index values as well. The index minus 2 returns the second item from the end of the list. That means the index minus 3 returns the third item from the end. That means third last item. And so forth and so on. Using individual values from a list. You can use individual values from a list just as you would any other variable. For example, you can use fstrings to create a message based on a value from a list. Let's try pulling the first color from the list and composing a message. So we need to type in message is equal to f within double quotes. My favorite color is, then within curly braces, colors at 0 index number dot title, double quotes close. Print message. At 1, we build a sentence using the value at color 0 and assign it to the variable message. The output is a simple sentence about the first color in the list. So my favorite color is blue. Now it's time to try it yourself. So try these short programs to get some first-hand experience with Python's list. You might want to create a new folder for each chapter's exercises to keep them organized. Names. Store the names of few of your friends in a list called names. Print each person's name by accessing each element in the list one at a time. Greetings. Start with the list you used in exercise 3.1, but instead of just printing each person's name, print a message to them. The text of each message should be the same, but each message should be personalized with the person's name. Your own list. Think of your favorite mode of transportation, such as a motorcycle or a car, and make a list that stores several examples. Use your list to print a series of statements about these items, such as, I would like to own a Honda motorcycle. Changing, adding, and removing elements. Most lists you create will be dynamic, meaning you will build a list and then add and remove elements from it as your program runs its course. For example, you might create a game in which a player has to shoot aliens out of the sky. You could store the initial set of aliens in a list and then remove an alien from the list each time one is shot down. Each time a new alien appears on the screen, you add it to the list. Your list of aliens will increase and decrease in length throughout the course of the game. Modifying elements in a list. The syntax for modifying an element is similar to the syntax for accessing an element in a list. To change an element, use the name of the list followed by the index of the element you want to change, and then provide the new value you want that item to have. For example, let's say we have a list of motorcycles and the first item in the list is Honda. How would we change the value of this first item? Well, we need to type in motorcycles is equal to within square brackets Honda, comma, Yamaha, comma, Suzuki. Now each element must be in single quote. Now we want to print motorcycles, so we need to type in print motorcycles. Then motorcycles 0, since we want to print the first motorcycle, is equal to Ducati. Print motorcycles. The code at one number defines the original list with Honda as the first element. The code at number 2 changes the value of the first item to Ducati. The output shows that the first item has indeed been changed and the rest of the list stay the same. So Honda, comma Yamaha, comma Suzuki, and then we can see Ducati, comma Yamaha, comma Suzuki. You can change the value of any item in a list, not just the first item. Adding elements to a list. You might want to add a new element to a list for many reasons. For example, you might want to make new aliens appear in a game, add new data to a visualization, or add new registered users to a website. Python provides several ways to add new data to existing list. Appending elements to end of a list. The simplest way to add a new element to a list is to append the item to the list. When you append an item to a list, the new element is added to the end of the list. Using the same list we had in the previous example, we will add the new element Ducati to the end of the list. So what we need to do is, we need to type in motorcycles.append within parentheses Ducati, that must be in single quotes, print motorcycles. The append method at number 1 adds Ducati to the end of the list without affecting any of other elements in the list. So Honda, Yamaha, comma Suzuki, Honda, Yamaha, comma Suzuki, comma Ducati. The append method makes it easy to build list dynamically. For example, you can start with an empty list and then add items to the list using a series of append calls. Using an empty list, let's add the elements Honda, Yamaha, and Suzuki to the list. So motorcycles is equal to square brackets. Now we can see this is an empty list. Now we want to add elements to this list. So we need to type in motorcycles.append within parenthesis Honda. Motorcycles.append Yamaha. Motorcycles.append Suzuki. Print motorcycles. The resulting list looks exactly the same as the list in the previous example. So our output will be something like this: Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki. Building list this way is very common because you often won't know the data your users want to store in a program until after the program is running. To put your users in control, start by defining an empty list that will hold the user's values, then append each new value provided to the list you just created. Inserting elements into a list. You can add a new element at any position in your list just by using the insert method. You do this by specifying the index of the new element and the value of the new item. For example, let's say we have a list motorcycles is equal to within square brackets Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki. Motorcycles.insert 0 Ducati. So at 0 index number, we want to insert a new element in the list called Ducati. Now if we type print motorcycles, then we will get the output Ducati, Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki separated by commas. Since we have added Ducati at index number 0, so it will appear in the beginning. So in this example, the code at number 1 inserts the value Ducati at the beginning of the list. The insert method opens a space at position 0 and stores the value Ducati at that location. This operation shifts every other value in the list one position to the right. Removing elements from a list. Often you will want to remove an item or set of items from a list. For example, when a player shoots down an alien from the sky, you'll most likely want to remove it from the list of active aliens. Or when a user decides to cancel their account on a web application you created, you will want to remove that user from the list of active users. You can remove an item according to its position in the list or according to its value. So removing an item using the del statement. Now if you know the position of the item you want to remove from a list, you can use the del statement. So let's say we have a list motorcycles is equal to Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki, print motorcycles. Now del motorcycles 0. So the motorcycle that is at index 0 will be removed. So if we type print motorcycles, now Honda will not be available in the list. So the code at number 1 uses del to remove the first item Honda from the list of motorcycles, and our output will be something like this. You can remove an item from any position in a list using the del statement, but the condition is that you must know the index number. If you don't know the index number, this statement is not going to help you. For example, here's how to remove the second item Yamaha in the list. So to remove the second item, as we know, the second item will be at index number 1 because index number starts from 0. So first item at 0 index, second item at index 1. So del motorcycles 1 print motorcycles. Now the second motorcycle is deleted from the list, as we can see over here. Initially we have Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki. When we removed the second item or second element from the list, we got Honda, Suzuki. In both examples, you can no longer access the value that was removed from the list after the del statement is used. Removing an item using the pop method. Sometimes you'll want to use the value of an item after you remove it from a list. For example, you might want to remove a user from a list of active members and then add that user to a list of inactive members. The pop method removes the last item in a list, but it lets you work with that item after removing it. The term pop comes from thinking of a list as a stack of items and popping one item off the top of the stack. In this analogy, the top of stack corresponds to the end of a list. Let's pop a motorcycle from the list of motorcycles. So we have a list, motorcycles is equal to, within square brackets, Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki, print motorcycles. Now we are going to pop out one motorcycle. So popped underscore motorcycle is equal to motorcycles.pop. So here we are using pop method. Now print motorcycles, print popped underscore motorcycles. We start by defining and printing the list of motorcycles at statement number 1. At statement number 2, we pop a value from the list and then we store that value in the variable popped underscore motorcycle. We print the list at statement number 3 to show that a value has been removed from the list. Then we print the popped value at number 4 to prove that we still have access to the value that was removed. The output shows that the value Suzuki was removed from the end of the list and is now assigned to the variable popped underscore motorcycle. So here we can see all the outputs. Initially we have a list Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki. So we can see there are 3 motorcycles in this list. Then we popped a motorcycle from the list and now we have only Honda, Yamaha. We also printed the popped underscore motorcycle. So the value that is stored in popped underscore motorcycle is Suzuki because this element was removed or popped out from the list. So you can clearly see that we still have the access to popped out element. Now the question is, how might this pop method be useful? Imagine that motorcycles in the list are stored in chronological order according to when we owned them. If this is the case, we can use the pop method to print a statement about the last motorcycle we bought. So we have a list called motorcycles is equal to Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki. Last underscore owned is equal to motorcycles.pop. Print within parenthesis F within double quotes, the last motorcycle I owned was a, then within curly braces, last underscore owned dot title, then double quotes close. The output is a simple sentence about the most recent motorcycle we owned. So the output will be, the last motorcycle I owned was a Suzuki. Popping items from any position in a list. You can use pop method to remove an item from any position in a list. And to do that, you need to include the index of the item you want to remove in parentheses. Let's see this in example. First underscore owned is equal to motorcycles.pop within parentheses 0. So 0 is the index number of that element we want to remove. Now we are going to write the second statement. Print within parenthesis F within double quotes, the first motorcycle I owned was a, within curly braces, first underscore owned dot title. We start by popping the first motorcycle in the list at statement 1 and then we print a message about that motorcycle at statement number 2. The output is a simple sentence, describes the first motorcycle I ever owned. So the first motorcycle I owned was a Honda. Now remember that each time you use pop method, the item you work with is no longer stored in the list. If you are unsure whether to use the del statement or the pop method, Here's a simple way to decide. When you want to delete an item from a list and not use that item in any way, use the del statement. But if you want to use an item as you remove it, use the pop method. Removing an item by value. Sometimes you won't know the position of the value you want to remove from a list. If you only know the value of the item you want to remove, you can use the remove method. For example, let's say we want to remove the value Ducati from the list of motorcycles. So this is the list that we have. Motorcycles is equal to, within square bracket, Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki, Ducati. Print motorcycles. Now to remove Ducati, that means the last element, we need to type in motorcycles.remove, then the value of that value we want to remove. So Ducati. Print motorcycle once again. Now the code at statement number 1 tells Python to figure out where Ducati appears in the list and remove that element. So initially when we typed print motorcycles, we got this list: Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki and Ducati. But after removing Ducati, when we tried to print the statement, we got this list: Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki. You can also use the remove method to work with value that's being removed from a list. Let's remove the value Ducati and print a reason for removing it from the list. So we already have the list and we are not going to type it out. Now, to_expensive is equal to Ducati, motorcycles.remove to_expensive. Print motorcycles, print f\na within curly braces to_expensive.title is too expensive for me. After defining the list at statement number 1, we assign the value Ducati to a variable called toExpensive in statement number 2. We then use this variable to tell Python which value to remove from the list at statement number 3. At statement number 4, the value Ducati has been removed from the list, but it is still accessible through the variable to_expensive. Allowing us to print a statement about why we removed Ducati from the list of motorcycles. So our outputs will be something like this. Initially we have the list Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki and Ducati. Then we removed Ducati from the list and we got this list: Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki. Now still after removing Ducati from the list, we have access to it. And that is why we are able to print this statement: a Ducati is too expensive for me. Now it's time to try it yourself. So, guest list. If you could invite anyone living or deceased to dinner, who would you invite? Make a list that includes at least 3 people you would like to invite to dinner. Then use your list to print a message to each person inviting them to dinner. Changing guest list. You just heard that one of your guests can't make the dinner, so you need to send out a new set of invitations. You will have to think of someone else to invite. So start with your program from exercise 3-4. Add a print call at the end of your program stating the name of the guest who can't make it. Modify your list, replacing the name of the guest who can't make it with the name of the new person you are inviting. Print a second set of invitation messages, one for each person who is still in your list. More guests. You just found a bigger dinner table. So now more space is available. Think of 3 more guests to invite to dinner. Start with your program from exercise 3-4 or exercise 3-5. Add a print call to the end of your program informing people that you find a bigger dinner table. Use insert to add one new guest to the beginning of your list. Use insert to add one new guest to the middle of your list. Then use append to add one new guest to the end of your list. Then print a new set of invitation messages, one for each person in your list. Shrinking guest list. You just found out that your new dinner table won't arrive in time for the dinner, and you have space for only two guests. Start with your program from exercise 3-6. Add a line that prints a message saying that you can invite only two people for dinner. Use pop to remove guests from your list one at a time until only two names remain in your list. Each time you pop a name from your list, print a message to that person letting them know you are sorry you can't invite them to dinner. Print a message to each of two people still on your list, letting them know they are still invited. Use del to remove the last two names from your list so you have an empty list. Print your list to make sure you actually have an empty list at the end of your program. Organizing a list. Often, your list will be created in an unpredictable order because you can't always control the order in which your guest user provide their data. Although this is unavoidable in most circumstances, you will frequently want to present your information in a particular order. Sorting a list permanently with a sort method. Python's sort method makes it relatively easy to sort a list. Imagine we have a list of cars and we want to change the order of the list to store them alphabetically. To keep the task simple, let's assume that all the values in the list are lowercase. So cars is equal to BMW, Audi, Toyota, Subaru. Now we are going to add this sort method. So cars.sort, then print cars. The sort method shown at statement number 1 changes the order of the list permanently. The cars are now in alphabetical order and we can never revert to the original order. So if we want to go back to BMW, Audi, Toyota, Subaru, we will not be able to get that original order. Now our new order is Audi, BMW, Subaru, Toyota. So we can see the first letter of each car is different. It is in alphabetical order. So first we have A, then we have B, then we have S, and finally we have letter T. So all these cars are arranged in alphabetical order. One more thing that you need to know is you can also sort this list in reverse alphabetical order just by passing the argument reverse is equal to true to the sort method. The following example sorts the list of cars in reverse alphabetical order. So, to sort the list in reverse alphabetical order, we just need to type in cars.sort reverse is equal to true. Print cars. Again, the order of the list is permanently changed. So now we can see that the last car, that was Toyota, is on the first index number. The second last, that was Subaru, is on the second index number, that is 1, and so forth and so on. Sorting a list temporarily with the sorted function. To maintain the original order of a list but present it in a sorted order, you can use the sorted function. The sorted function lets you display your list in a particular order but doesn't affect the actual order of the list. So let's try this function on the list of cars. So we just need to type in print within double quotes, here is the original list, print cars. Our second statement is print \n, here is the sorted list, print sorted cars. Our third statement is print \n, here is the original list again, print cars. We first print the list in its original order at statement number 1 and then in alphabetical order at statement number 2. After the list is displayed in the new order, we show that the list is still sorted in its original order at statement number 3. So we can see that here is the original list: BMW, Audi, Toyota, Subaru. Here is the sorted list, which is alphabetical order: Audi, BMW, Subaru, Toyota. And here is the original list again: BMW, Audi, Toyota, and Subaru. Notice that the list still exists in its original order at statement number 4 after the sorted function has been used. The sorted function can also accept a reverse is equal to true argument if you want to display a list in reverse alphabetical order. Printing a list in reverse order. To reverse the original order of a list, you can use the reverse method. If we originally stored the list of cars in chronological order according to when we owned them, we could easily rearrange the list into reverse chronological order. So let's say we have a list. Now if we print cars, we will get the list that we have. If you want to reverse the order, we just need to type in cars.reverse print cars. Notice that the reverse doesn't sort backward alphabetically, it simply reverses the order of the list. So initially we have BMW, Audi, Toyota, Subaru. Now we have the reverse order. So the last one is first and the first one is last. So the new list is Subaru, Toyota, Audi, BMW. In fact, this is not a new list, but it is the reverse order of the original list. The reverse method changes the order of a list permanently. But you can revert to the original order anytime by applying reverse to the same list a second time. Finding the length of a list. You can quickly find the length of a list by using the len function. The list in this example has 4 items. So that means its length is 4. If any list has 5 elements or 5 items in it, that means the length of that list is 5. So we have a list like this: cars is equal to BMW, Audi, Toyota, Subaru. Now if we want to find out the length of this list, we just need to type in. And now we can see that the length of this list is 4. Now here we need to keep in mind one thing. Since this is a small list, so we can count the elements in this list. So it doesn't seem to be useful finding the or using the length function. But let's assume there is a list that contains lakhs of elements or lakhs of items in it. In that situation, we can't count all the elements. This is not practically possible. So in that case, this length function is going to be very helpful. So you will find the length function useful when you need to identify the number of aliens that still need to be shot down in a game, determine the amount of data you have to manage in a visualization, or figure out the number of registered users on a website, among other tasks. Now it's time to try it yourself. Seeing the world. Think of at least 5 places in the world you would like to visit. Now, store the location in a list. Make sure the list is not in alphabetical order. Now print your list in its original order. Don't worry about printing the list neatly, just print it as a raw Python list. Use sorted to print your list in alphabetical order without modifying the actual list. Show that your list is still in its original order by printing it. Use sorted to print your list in reverse alphabetical order without changing the order of the original list. Show that your list is still in its original order just by printing it again. Now use reverse to change the order of your list. Print the list to show that its order has changed. Now use reverse to change the order of your list again. Print the list to show it's back to its original order. Use sort to change your list so it's stored in reverse alphabetical order. Print the list to show that its order has changed. Dinner guests. Working with one of the programs from exercise 3.4 through 3.7, Use length function to print a message indicating the number of people you are inviting to dinner. Every function. Think of something you could store in a list. For example, you could make a list of mountains, rivers, countries, cities, languages, or anything else you would like. Now you need to write a program that creates a list containing these items and then uses each function introduced in this chapter at least once. Avoiding index error when working with list. One type of error is common to see when you are working with list for the first time. Let's say you have a list with 3 items and you ask for the 4th item. Let's say we have this list, motorcycles is equal to Honda, Yamaha, Suzuki. Print motorcycles 3. That means we want to print the motorcycle at index number 3. But as we can see, there are only 3 motorcycles and their index number will be 0, 1, 2. And there will be no index number 3 in this list. So this will create an error. So trace back most recent call last while motorcycles.py line 2 in module print motorcycles 3 index error list index out of range. Since there is no index number 3 in this list, that is why it is creating an index error. So Python attempts to give you the item at index number 3. But when it searches the list, no item in motorcycles has an index number 3. An index error means Python can't find an item at the index you requested. If an index error occurs in your program, try adjusting the index you are asking for by 1, then run the program again to see if the results are correct. Keep in mind that whenever you want to access the last item in a list, you use the index minus 1. This will always work, even if your list has changed size since the last time you accessed it. So if we want to access the last item, we just need to type in print motorcycles and the index number that we need to type in here is minus 1. The index minus 1 always returns the last item in your list. In this case, the value of the last item is Suzuki, so our output will be Suzuki. The only time this approach will cause an error is when you request the last item from an empty list. So let's say we don't have any element in the list and we request the last item. So let's say this is the list that we have, motorcycles is equal to square brackets and there is no element in this list. Now we try to print out print motorcycles and the index number that we give here is minus 1. Since there is no item in this list or no elements in this list, so Python returns another index error. Trace back most recent call last while motorcycles.py line 3 in module print motorcycles index number minus 1 index error list index out of range. So this will also create an index error. So till now we have seen index error can be created in two situations. The first, when we request for an index number that is not available in the list, or if we try to fetch an item or element from a list that is not existing. For example, in this case, we tried to find out the last element which is not available in the list. So in both the cases, an index error will be generated. Now, it's time to try it yourself. Intentional error. If you haven't received an index error in one of your programs yet, try to make one happen. Change an index in one of your programs to produce an index error. Make sure you correct the error before closing the program. Now it's time for the summary. So in this chapter you learned what lists are and how to work with the individual items in a list. You learned how to define a list and how to add and remove elements from a list. You learn to sort list permanently and temporarily for display responses. You also learned how to find the length of a list and how to avoid index errors when you are working with the list. In chapter 4, you will learn how to work with items in a list more efficiently by looping through each item in a list using just a few lines of code. You will be able to work more efficiently, even when your list contains thousands or millions of items. Working with lists. In this chapter, you will learn how to loop through an entire list using just a few lines of code, regardless of how long the list is. Looping allows you to take the same action or set of actions with every item in a list. As a result, you will be able to work efficiently with list of any length. So it doesn't matter what the length of the list is, you will be able to work on those lists. Looping through an entire list. You will often want to run through all entries in a list, performing the same task with each item. For example, in a game, you might want to move every element on the screen by the same amount, or in a list of numbers, you might want to perform the same statistical operation on every element. Or perhaps you will want to display each headline from a list of articles on a website. When you want to do the same action with every item in a list, you can use Python's for loop. Let's say we have a list of magicians' names and we want to print out each name in the list. We could do this by retrieving each name from the list individually, but this approach could cause several problems. For one, it would be repetitive to do this with a long list of names. Also, we had have to change our code each time the list length changed. A for loop avoids both of these issues by letting Python manage these issues internally. So let's use for loop to print out each name in a list of magicians. So let's say this is the list of magicians. So magicians is equal to Alice, David, Carolina. For magician in magicians, print magician. We define a for loop. This line tells Python to pull a name from the list magicians and associate it with the variable magician. We tell Python to print the name that's just been assigned to magician. Python then repeat line statement number 2 and statement number 3 once for each name in the list. It might help to read this code as for every magician in the list of magicians. Print the magician's name. The output is a simple printout of each name in the list. So we get the output in this form: Alice, David, Carolina. A closer look at looping. The concept of looping is important because it's one of the most common ways a computer automates repetitive tasks. For example, in a simple loop like we used in magicians.py, Python initially reads the first line of the loop for magician in magicians. Now this line tells Python to retrieve the first value from the list magicians and associate it with the variable magician. The first value is Alice. Python then reads the next line, print magician. Python prints the current value of magician, which is still Alice, because the list contains more values. Python returns to the first line of the loop for magician in magicians. Now Python retrieves the next name in the list, which is David, and associates that value with the variable magician. Python then executes the line print magician. Python prints the current value of magician again, which is now David. Python repeats the entire loop once more with the last value in the list, Carolina. Because no more values are in the list, Python moves on to the next line in the program. In this case, nothing comes after the for loop, so the program simply ends. When you are using loops for the first time, keep in mind that the set of steps is repeated once for each item in the list, no matter how many items are in the list. Also keep in mind When writing your own for loops, that you can choose any name you want for the temporary variable that will be associated with each value in the list. However, it's helpful to choose a meaningful name that represents a single item from the list. For example, here's a good way to start a for loop for a list of cats, a list of dogs, and a general list of items. For cat in cats, for dog in dogs, for item in list of items. These naming conventions can help you follow the action being done on each item within a for loop. Using singular and plural names can help you identify whether a section of code is working with a single element from the list or the entire list. Doing more work within a for loop. You can do just about anything with each item in a for loop. Let's build on the previous example by printing a message to each magician, telling them that they performed a great trick. So, we have the same list that we have above. Now, we need to write the print statement. So, print within parentheses F, within double quotes, within curly braces, magician.title, comma, that was a great trick, exclamation mark, double quotes close, and parenthesis close. The only difference in this code is at statement number 1, where we compose a message to each magician, starting with that magician's name. The first time through the loop, the value of magician is Alice. So, Python starts the first message with the name Alice. The second time through the message will begin with David. And the third time through the message will begin with Carolina. The output shows a personalized message for each magician in the list. So we will get output something like this. Alice, comma, that was a great trick. David, comma, that was a great trick. Carolina, that was a great trick. You can also write as many lines of code as you like in the for loop. Every indented line following the line for magician in magicians is considered inside the loop, and each indented line is executed once for each. So, print within parentheses F, double quotes, I can't wait to see your next trick, comma, within curly braces, magician.title dot backslash n, double quotes close and parenthesis close. We will get an output something like this. Alice, that was a great trick. I can't wait to see your next trick, Alice. David, that was a great trick. I can't wait to see your next trick, David. Carolina, that was a great trick. I can't wait to see your next trick, Carolina. Now we can type in print within parentheses and double quotes. Thank you, everyone. That was a great magic show. The first two calls to print are repeated once for each magician in the list, as you saw earlier. However, because the line at statement number 1 is not indented, so it's pointed only once. So this time our output will be something like this. Alice, that was a great trick. I can't wait to see your next trick, Alice. David, that was a great trick. I can't wait to see your next trick, David. Carolina, that was a great trick. I can't wait to see your next trick, Carolina. And thank you, everyone. That was a great magic show. When you are processing data using a for loop, you will find that this is a good way to summarize an operation that was performed on an entire data set. For example, you might use a for loop to initialize a game by running through a list of characters and displaying each character on the screen, avoiding indentation errors. As all of us know, Python uses indentation to determine how a line or group of lines is related to the rest of the program. In the previous examples, the lines that printed message to individual magicians were part of the for loop because they were indented. Python's use of indentation makes code very easy to read. Basically, it uses white space to force you to write neatly formatted code with a clear visual structure. In longer Python programs, you will notice blocks of code indented at a few different levels. These indentation levels help you gain a general sense of the overall program's organization. So as you begin to write code that relies on proper indentation, you will need to watch for a few common indentation errors. For example, people sometimes indent lines of code that don't need to be indented or forget to indent lines that need to be indented. Seeing examples of these errors now will help you avoid them in the future and correct them when they do appear in your own program. So let's examine some of the more common indentation errors. The first error can be forgetting to indent. Always indent the line after the for statement in a loop. If you forget it, Python will remind you. For example, let's say we have the list magicians is equal to Alice, David, Carolina. Now we are going to write a for statement. So for magician in magicians. Now we are going to print magician. The call to print statement number 1 should be indented, but it's not. When Python expects an indented block and doesn't find one, it lets you know which line it had a problem with. For example, in this case, file magicians.py, line 3, print magician, indentation error, expected an indented block. You can usually resolve this kind of the indentation errors just by indenting the line or lines immediately after the for statement. The next error can be forgetting to indent additional lines. Now sometimes what happens, your loop will run without any errors but won't produce the expected result. This can happen when you are trying to do several tasks in a loop and you forget to indent some of its lines. For example, this is what happens when we forget to indent the second line in the loop that tells each magician we are looking forward to their next trick. So we have a list magicians is equal to Alice, David, Carolina. For loop for magician in magicians. Now print within parenthesis F within double quotes and curly braces magician.title, comma, that was a great trick, double quotes close and parenthesis close. Then print within parenthesis F within double quotes, I can't wait to see your next trick, comma, within curly braces magician.title dot backslash n, double quotes and parenthesis close. The call to print function at statement number 1 is supposed to be indented, but because Python finds at least one indented line after the for statement, it doesn't report an error. As a result, the first print call is executed once for each name in the list because it is indented. The second print call is not indented, so it is executed only once after the loop has finished running, because the final value associated with magician is Carolina. She is the only one who receives the looking forward to the next trick message. So our outputs will be Alice, that was a great trick. David, that was a great trick. But with Carolina, that was a great trick. And I can't wait to see your next trick, Carolina. So this is a logical error. The syntax is valid Python code, but the code does not produce the desired result because a problem occurs in its logic. If you expect to see a certain action repeated once for each item in a list and it's executed only once, determine whether you need to simply indent a line or a group of lines. Indenting unnecessarily. Now, if you accidentally indent a line that doesn't need to be indented, Python informs you about the unexpected indent. For example, message is equal to within double quotes hello python word, print message. Now we don't need to indent the print call at statement number 1 because it isn't part of a loop. Hence, Python reports that error. So we will get an error something like this: file hello underscore word dot py line number 2, print message. Now indentation error, unexpected indent. You can avoid unexpected indentation errors by indenting only when you have a specific reason to do so. In the programs you are writing at this point, the only lines you should indent are the actions you want to repeat for each item in a for loop, indenting unnecessarily after the loop. If you accidentally indent code that should run after a loop has finished, that code will be repeated once for each item in the list. So sometimes this prompts Python to report an error, but often this will result in a logical error. For example, let's see what happens when we accidentally indent the line that thanked the magicians as a group for putting on a good show. So we have a list: magicians is equal to Alice, comma David, comma Carolina. For loop for magician in magicians, print f magician dot title, comma that was a great trick. Print f I can't wait to see your next trick. Magician dot title dot backslash n. Print thank you everyone. That was a great magic show. Because the line at statement number 1 is indented, it's printed once for each person in the list, as shown here. Alice, that was a great trick. I can't wait to see your next trick, Alice. Thank you, everyone. That was a great magic show. David, that was a great trick. I can't wait to see your next trick, David. Thank you, everyone. That was a great magic show. Carolina, that was a great trick. I can't wait to see your next trick, Carolina. And finally, thank you everyone. That was a great magic show. This is another logical error because Python doesn't know what you are trying to accomplish with your code. It will run all code that is written in valid syntax. If an action is repeated many times when it should be executed only once, you probably need to unindent the code for that action. Forgetting the colon. The colon at the end of a for statement tells Python to interpret the next line as the start of a loop. For example, magicians is equal to Alice, comma David, comma Carolina. For magician in magicians, print magician. Now, if you accidentally forget the colon as shown at statement number 1, you will get a syntax error because Python doesn't know what you are trying to do. Now it's time for try it yourself. Pizzas. Think of at least 3 kinds of your favorite pizza. Store these pizza names in a list and then use a for loop to print the name of each pizza. Now what you need to do is you need to modify your for loop to print a sentence using the name of the pizza instead of printing just the name of the pizza. For each pizza, you should have one line of output containing a simple statement like I like pepperoni pizza. Now add a line at the end of your program outside the for loop that states how much you like pizza. The output should consist of 3 or more lines about the kinds of pizza you like, and then an additional sentence such as I really love pizza. Animals. Think of at least 3 different animals that have a common characteristic. Store the names of these animals in a list and then use a for loop to print out the name of each animal. Modify your program to print a statement about each animal such as a dog would make a great pet. Then add a line at the end of your program stating what these animals have in common. You could print a sentence such as any of these animals would make a great pet or something like that. Now let's talk about making numerical lists. Lists are ideal for storing sets of numbers, and Python provides a variety of tools to help you work efficiently with list of numbers. Some of these tools are using the range function. Python's range function makes it easy to generate a series of numbers. For example, you can use the range function to print a series of numbers like this. For value in range 1,5, colon, print value. Although this code looks like it should print the numbers from 1 to 5, it doesn't print the number 5. And our output is 1, 2, 3, 4. We don't have number 5. So in this example, range prints only the numbers 1 through 4. This is another result of the off by 1 behavior you will see often in programming languages. The range function causes Python to start counting at the first value you give it, and it stops when it reaches the second value you provide. Because it stops at the second value, the output never contains the end value, which would have been 5 in this case. To print the number from 1 to 5, you would use range 1,6. So it will start at 6, but it will print 5. Okay? So to do so, we need to type in for value in range 1,6, colon. This time, the output starts at 1 and ends at 5. So our output is 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. If your output is different than what you expect when you are using range, try adjusting your end value by 1. You can also pass range only one argument, and it will start the sequence of numbers at 0. For example, range 6. Now this would return the numbers from 0 through 5. Using range to make a list of numbers. Now if you want to make a list of numbers, you can convert the results of range directly into a list using list function. So when you wrap list around a call to the range function, the output will be a list of numbers. So we can use list to convert set of numbers into a list. So we need to just type in numbers is equal to list within parenthesis range, once again within parenthesis 1,6. Now whatever the output of range is, it will be stored in the list, print numbers. And this is the result 1,2,3,4,5. We can also use the range function to tell Python to skip numbers in a given range. If you pass a third argument to range, Python uses that value as a step size when generating numbers. For example, here's how to list the even numbers between 1 and 10. So even underscore numbers is equal to list within parenthesis range, once again within parenthesis 2,11,2, print even numbers. In this example, the range function starts with the value 2 and then adds 2 to that value. It adds 2 repeatedly until it reaches or passes the end value 11 and produces this result 2,4,6,8,10, and we can see all of these are even numbers. So you can create almost any set of numbers you want to using the range function. For example, consider how you might make a list of the first 10 square numbers, that is the square of each integer from 1 through 10. So in Python, 2 asterisk represents exponents, and I have already told you. So here's how you might put the first 10 square numbers into a list. So we just need to type in squares is equal to square brackets. Now this is an empty list for value in range 1,11. Square is equal to value 2 multiplication sign 2. Now squares dot append square. Print squares. So we start with an empty list called squares at statement number 1. At statement number 2, we tell Python to loop through each value from 1 to 10 using the range function. Inside the loop, the current value is raised to the second power and assigned to the variable square in statement number 3. At statement number 4, each new value of square is appended to the list of squares. So finally, when the loop has finished running, the list of squares is printed in statement number 5. Now the output will be something like this: 1, 4, 9, 16, 25, 36, 49, 64, 81, 100. So these are the squares of first 10 numbers. To write this code more concisely, omit the temporary variable square and append each new value directly to the list. So what we need to do is, we need to type squares.append value 2 multiplication sign and 2 and just print squares. The code at statement number 1 does the same work as the lines at statement number 3 and statement number 4 in the squares.py. Each value in the loop is raised to the second power and then immediately appended to the list of squares. You can use either of these two approaches when you are making more complex lists. Sometimes using a temporary variable makes your code easier to read. Other times, it makes the code unnecessarily long. Focus first on writing code that you understand clearly, which does what you want it to do. Then look for more efficient approaches as you review your code. Now let's talk about simple statistics with a list of numbers. There are a few Python functions that are helpful when you're working with a list of numbers. For example, you can easily find the minimum, maximum, and sum of a list of numbers. So let's say we have some digits or list of digits. So digits is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 0. To find the minimum out of this list, we just need to type in min within parentheses digits 0, max within parentheses digits, and the output will be 9. If you want to find the sum of all these numbers, we just need to type in sum within parentheses digits and we get the answer 45. So this is how we can find the minimum number or the maximum number or the sum of numbers from a list. Now let's talk about list comprehensions. The approach described earlier for generating the list squares consisted of using 3 or 4 lines of code. A list comprehension allows you to generate the same list in just one line of code. A list comprehension combines the for loop and the creation of new elements into one line and automatically appends each new element. The following example builds the same list of squared numbers you saw earlier but uses a list comprehension. So squares is equal to within square bracket value 2 multiplication sign or asterisk sign 2 for value in range within parentheses 1, 11, then square bracket close, then print squares. To use this syntax, begin with a descriptive name for the list such as squares. Next, open a set of square brackets and define the expression for the values you want to store in the new list. In this example, the expression is value 2 asterisk sign and 2, which raises the value to the second power. Then write a for loop to generate the numbers you want to feed into the expression. and close the square brackets. The for loop in this example is for value in range 1, 11, which fits the values 1 through 10 into the expression value 2 times multiplication sign or asterisk sign 2. Now notice that no colon is used at the end of for statement. The result is the same list of square numbers you saw earlier. So we can see the output is 1, 4, 9, 16, 25, 36, 49, 64, 81, 100. Okay, now it's time to try it yourself. Counting to 20. Use a for loop to print the numbers from 1 to 20 inclusive. 1 million. Make a list of the numbers from 1 to 1 million and then use a for loop to print the numbers. If the output is taking too long, stop it by pressing Ctrl C or by closing the output window. Summing a million. Make a list of the numbers from 1 to 1 million and then use min function and max function to make sure your list actually starts at 1 and ends at 1 million. Also, use the sum function to see how quickly Python can add a million numbers. Odd numbers. Use the third argument of the range function to make a list of the odd numbers from 1 to 20. Use a for loop to print each number. Threes. Make a list of the multiples of 3 from 3 to 30. Use a for loop to print the numbers in your list. Cubes. A number raised to the third power is called cubes, and we all know this. For example, the cube of 2 is written as 2 raised to the power of 3 in Python. So, make a list of the first 10 cubes, that is, the cube of each integer from 1 through 10, and use a for loop to print out the value of each cube. Cube comprehension. Use a list comprehension to generate a list of the first 10 cubes. Working with part of a list. In chapter 3, you learned how to access single elements in a list, and in this chapter, you have been learning how to work through all the elements in a list. You can also work with a specific group of items in a list, which Python calls a slice. So, now we are going to talk about slicing a list. To make a slice, you specify the index of the first and last element you want to work with. As with the range function, so Python stops one item before the second index you specify. To output the first three elements in a list, you would request indices 0 through 3, which would return elements 0, 1, and 2. The following example involves a list of players on a team. So we have players is equal to Virat, Sachin, Dhoni, Hardik, Rohit. Print players 0, 3 within a square bracket. The code at statement number 1 prints a slice of the list, which includes just the first three players. The output retains the structure of the list and includes the first three players in the list. So the output is Virat, Sachin, and Dhoni. You can generate any subset of a list. For example, if you want the second, third, and fourth items in a list, you would start the slice at index 1 and end at index 4. So we need to type in print players 1, 4. This time, the slice starts with Sachin and ends with Hardik. Now, this time our output will be Sachin, Dhoni, Hardik. If you omit the first index in a slice, Python automatically starts your slice at the beginning of the list. So if we type print players within square bracket colon 4, so withouting a starting index, Python starts at the beginning of the list. So this time our outcome will be Virat, Sachin, Dhoni, Hardik. A similar syntax works if you want a slice that includes the end of a list. For example, if you want all items from the third item to the last item, you can start with index 2 and omit the second index. So in this case, we need to type in print players within square bracket 2 colon. We don't need to type any end index. Now Python returns all items from the third item to the end of the list. So this time our output will be Dhoni, Hardik and Rohit. This syntax allows you to output all of the elements from any point in your list to the end regardless of the length of the list. Recall that a negative index returns an element a certain distance from the end of a list. Therefore, you can output any slice from the end of a list. For example, if you want to output the last three players on the roster, we can use the slice players and then within square bracket, we can type in minus 3 colon. So we just need to type in print within parenthesis players and within square bracket minus 3 colon. Now this prints the names of the last three players and would continue to work as the list of players change in size. Looping through a slice. You can use a slice in a for loop if you want to loop through a subset of the elements in a list. In the next example, we loop through the first three players and print their names. So players is equal to Virat, Sachin, Dhoni, Hardik, Rohit. Print within parenthesis and within double quotes, here are the first three players on my team. For player in players, then within square bracket, colon 3. Print player.title. Now instead of looping through the entire list of players at statement number 1, Python loops through only the first three names. As a result, our output will be, here are the first three players on my team, Virat, Sachin, Dhoni. Slices are very useful in a number of situations. For instance, when you are creating a game, you could add a player's final score to a list every time that player finishes playing. You could then get a player's top three scores by sorting the list in decreasing order and taking a slice that includes just the first three scores. Now we are going to talk about copying a list. Often, you will want to start with an existing list and make an entirely new list based on the first one. Let's explore how copying a list works and examine one situation in which copying a list is useful. To copy a list, you can make a slice that includes the entire original list by omitting the first index and the second index. This tells Python to make a slice that starts at the first item and ends with the last item, producing a copy of the entire list. For example, imagine we have a list of our favorite foods and want to make a separate list of foods that a friend likes. This friend likes everything in our list so far, so we can create their list by copying ours. So, we need to type in my underscore foods is equal to within square bracket and within single quotes pizza, comma, within single quotes falafel, comma, within single quotes carrot cake. Then, friend underscore foods is equal to my underscore foods and within square bracket colon. Print within parenthesis and double quotes my favorite foods are and colon symbol. Then print my underscore foods. Then print within parenthesis and double quotes backslash n my friend's favorite foods are and colon symbol. Then print within parenthesis friend underscore foods. Now at statement number 1, we make a list of foods we like called my underscore foods. At statement number 2, we make a new list called friend underscore foods. We make a copy of my underscore foods by asking for a slice of my underscore foods without specifying any indices and store the copy in friend underscore foods. When we print each list, we see that they both contain the same foods. My favorite foods are pizza, falafel, and carrot cake. My friend's favorite foods are pizza, falafel, and carrot cake. To prove that we actually have two separate lists, we will add a new food to each list and show that each list keeps track of the appropriate person's favorite foods. So, my underscore foods dot append within parentheses and single quotes cannoli. Friend underscore foods dot append within parentheses and single quote ice cream. At statement 1, we copy the original items in my underscore foods to the new list friend underscore foods, as we did in the previous example. Next, we add a new food to each list. At statement number 2, we add cannoli to my underscore foods, and at statement number 3, we add ice cream to friend underscore foods. We then print the two lists to see whether each of these foods is in the appropriate list. So, my favorite foods are pizza, falafel, carrot cake, cannoli. My friend's favorite foods are pizza, falafel, carrot cake, and ice cream. The output at step number 4 shows the cannoli now appears in our list of favorite food, but ice cream doesn't. At statement number 5, we can see that ice cream now appears in our friends list, but cannoli doesn't. If we had simply set friend underscore foods equal to my underscore foods, we would not produce two separate lists. For example, here's what happens when you try to copy a list without using a slice. So we are going to comment here, hash this doesn't work. Friend underscore foods is equal to my underscore foods. Instead of storing a copy of my underscore foods in friend underscore foods at statement number 1, we set friend underscore foods equal to my underscore foods. This syntax actually tells Python to associate the new variable friend underscore foods with the list that is already associated with my underscore foods. So now, both variables point to the same list. As a result, when we add cannoli to my underscore foods, it will also appear in friend underscore food, because both are equal. Likewise, ice cream will appear in both lists, even though it appears to be added only to friend underscore foods. The output shows that both lists are the same now, which is not what we wanted. My favorite foods are pizza, falafel, carrot cake, cannoli, ice cream. My friend's favorite foods are pizza, falafel, carrot cake, cannoli, ice cream. Now it's time to try it yourself. Slices. Using one of the programs you wrote in this chapter, add several lines to the end of the program that do the following. Number 1. Print the message, the first three items in the list are. Then use a slice to print the first three items from that program's list. Print the message, three items from the middle of the list are. Use a slice to print three items from the middle of the list. Print the message, the last three items in the list are. Use a slice to print the last three items in the list. My pizzas, your pizzas. Start with your program from exercise 4.1. Make a copy of the list of pizzas and call it friend underscore pizzas. Then do the following. First, add a new pizza to the original list. Add a different pizza to the list friend underscore pizzas. Now prove that you have two separate lists. Print the message, my favorite pizzas are, and then use a for loop to print the first list. Print the message, my friend's favorite pizzas are, and then use a for loop to print the second list. Make sure each new pizza is stored in the appropriate list. More loops. All versions of force.py in this section have avoided using for loops when printing to save space. Choose a version of force.py and write two for loops to print each list of force. Styling your code. Python programmers have agreed on a number of styling conventions to ensure that everyone's code is structured in the same way. If you are hoping to become a professional programmer at some point, you should begin following these guidelines as soon as possible to develop good habits. The Style Guide. When someone wants to make a change to the Python language, they write a Python Enhancement Proposal, PEP. One of the oldest PEPs is PEP 8, which instructs Python programmers on how to style their code. The following guidelines will help you write clear code from the start. The first one is indentation. PIP 8 recommends that you use 4 spaces per indentation label. Using 4 spaces improves readability while leaving room for multiple labels of indentation on each line. Mixing tabs and spaces in your file can cause problems that are very difficult to diagnose. If you think you have a mix of tabs and spaces, you can convert all tabs in a file to spaces in most editors. Line length. Many Python programmers recommend that each line should be less than 80 characters. PIP8 also recommends that you limit all of your comments to 72 characters per line, because some of the tools that generate automatic documentation for larger projects add formatting characters at the beginning of each comment line. Don't worry too much about line length in your code as you are learning, but be aware that people who are working collaboratively almost always follow the PIP8 guidelines. Blank lines. To group parts of our program visually, use blank lines, but don't do so excessively. You should not place 3 or 4 blank lines between the two sections. Blank lines won't affect how your code runs, but they will affect the readability of your code. The Python interpreter uses horizontal indentation to interpret the meaning of your code, but it disregards vertical spacing. Now it's time for the summary. So, in this chapter, you learned how to work efficiently with the elements in a list. You learned how to work through a list using a for loop. How Python uses indentation to structure a program. And how to avoid some common indentation errors. You learned to make simple numerical lists as well as a few operations you can perform on numerical lists. You learned how to slice a list to work with a subset of items and how to copy list properly using a slice. You also learned about tuples, which provide a degree of protection to a set of values that shouldn't change, and how to style your increasingly complex code to make it easy to read. In Chapter 5, you will learn to respond appropriately to different conditions by using if statements. You will learn to string together relatively complex sets of conditional tests to respond appropriately to exactly the kind of situation or information you are looking for. You will also learn to use if statements while looping through a list to take specific action with selected elements from a list.
Hello and welcome to Programming Using Python by Electronics and ICT Academy, IIT Kanpur. In this module, we will look at for loop. But before we begin with for loop, we'll look at a very useful function called range in Python. In the most general form, range function takes 3 arguments. Here I have represented them using S, E, and D. And it generates a list which starts with the element S, and each subsequent element is obtained by adding the third argument D to the previous element. So the elements that we get are S, S plus D, S plus 2 times D, and so on, such that the last element is smaller than E. So What we have is a list where elements are d unit apart. The element start with s and the element end just before e. So s is included in the list, but e is not included in the list. There are two more variations of range function. Range s comma e, where the argument d is ignored, is equivalent to saying d is having value 1. So range se is equivalent to range se 1, which means we will generate sequence like s, s plus 1, s plus 2, s plus 3, up to but not including e. And then we can even skip the start argument. We can just say range up to an end argument e. This is equivalent to starting at value 0 and getting all the values 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, up to but not including e. So range e generates numbers from 0 up to e minus 1. So why this range function is useful, we will see when we discuss for. So let's take a simple example to understand for loops. Suppose we have to print the sum of reciprocals of the first 100 natural numbers. So we can do this problem using while loop as well, where we use a variable to hold numbers from 1 up to 100. And at each iteration of while loop, we increment the number and add its inverse or reciprocal to some variable. However, we can do it in much compact form using for loop, and here is the program. We start with a variable reciprocal sum called rsum in my program, and note that it's a floating point value 0.0, and then we go over the for loop. So now, according to the problem statement, I need all the numbers from 1 up to 100, and I can generate them compactly using this range function, but I have to be careful. The last argument of range, or the end argument, has to be 101, because I also want to include the number 100. So for I in range 1 comma 101, reciprocal sum accumulates inverse of I, that is 1.0 divided by I. Okay, we'll look at in details the body of this for and how this function executes in the next slide. So let's look at the execution of for loop. To keep things easier, I have changed the problem slightly. Instead of computing reciprocal or sum of first 100 natural numbers, I am computing it for first 4 natural numbers. So note the second argument of range is 5 and not 101. So I'm going from 1 up to 4. So how does this program execute? We look at the range expression and see that it will give us a sequence 1, 2, 3, and 4. The way for works is the sequence or the list 1, 2, 3, 4 is assigned to the for variable, in this case I, 1 by 1. So since the list contains 4 values, we bind I to the first value, that is 1. We enter the body to execute the first iteration of for loop. The value of I is 1, and after this iteration, the value of rsum also becomes 1.0. Since there are more values to process, we have not yet exhausted the list 1, 2, 3, 4. We will bind I to the next value in the sequence, that is 2, and then again execute the body of the loop. And now the value of I, when we are executing this body, the value of I is 2, and therefore rsum gets updated to 1.5. We keep doing this. Since there are more values, I gets the next value, that is 3. Rsum gets updated in the body. And finally, we have one more value to process, that is 4. So I becomes 4, and inside the body, rsum gets updated once again. Now, next time when we come to the start of the for loop, there are no more values to process. we have exhausted all the values that were there generated by range function. And since this list is exhausted, we come out of the loop and print the next statement or execute the next statement. And the output that comes to us is sum is 2.08333 for this simple example. So let's look at the most general form of for loop in Python. For loop is given by the keyword for, followed by a variable, followed by another keyword in, and then some sequence. So we have not discussed sequence yet, but to start with, you can think about a sequence as a list of values. Then we have the colon, and then body of for, which is once again indented with respect to the for keyword, just like we did for if and while. So remember, Python does not have opening and closing braces or begin end keyword. The body of a construct is found by the indentation with respect to the start of the construct. And how does for loop execute? So you first evaluate the sequence to get a list of values. If there are values in the sequence, that is sequence is not empty, then we go on to step 3, which is to process the sequence. Otherwise, once we have exhausted the sequence, we exit out of the loop. When there are values remaining in the sequence, we bind the variable, which is given in the for statement, to the next value in the sequence. So this way sequence keeps getting consumed. And then we execute the body of the for loop with variable having the binding that we just assigned in statement in the step number 3. After execution of the statement, we go back to step 2 to check whether there are more values in the sequence or not. So this is how for loop executes, and we have already seen the example. So let's have another example, another problem that can be given as assignment for you. So given a positive real number r and another real number a and a positive integer n, we say that the nth term of the geometric progression with a as the first term and r as the ratio is a r to the power n minus 1. Now in this problem, you have to write a program that takes the values of r, a and n from the user, and it displays the first n terms of the geometric progression. So this is how you start the program. The first part is reading inputs from the user. So you will read r, you will read a, and you will read n from the user. And after that, you have to write a for loop that will process these inputs and generate generate elements of the geometric sequence. So let's look at the rest of the program. The first term of the sequence is A itself. We print it, and then we move on to printing next few elements. So what will be the range in this case? We have to go from printing A r to the power 1 up to A r to the power n minus 1. Remember, nth term of geometric progression will be ar to the power n minus 1, and therefore our range goes from 1 up to n, and we are using variable I to get the corresponding sequence element in the sequence. So we obtain next term by just multiplying r with the previous term, and we just print it within the for loop because we are printing all the terms. So once again, the important point to note is when we say range 1, n, we get values 1, 2, 3, 4 up to n minus 1. In case n is less than or equal to 1, the range generated will be empty. In that case, for loop will not be executed at all. The body of the for loop will be skipped. Thank you for today's lecture. In today's module, we will look at nested loops. Since loops are statements in Python, loops can be part of another loop. So whenever we have loops within a loop, these are called nested loops. So in case of nested loop, many iterations of an inner loop result into one iteration of outer loop. An example from day-to-day life is that of a watch or a stopwatch. In a watch or a clock, when seconds hand moves 60 steps, only then minutes hand moves one step. And similarly, when minutes hand moves 60 steps, our hand moves one step. So this is very similar to how loops work in programming as well. So loops are typically required when you have more than one directions in which things can move. We will drive nested loops with few examples. So suppose I want to write a program that displays the pattern which is shown on your screen. So first line prints 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Second line has 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. Third line has 3, 6, 9, 12, 15. So these are multiplication tables of numbers. The numbers themselves are growing in a column, and each row has table corresponding to that number. Okay. So how do we write a program that prints this display? So we need two movements, one which prints the table of a given number in a row, and another movement to print the number themselves in the column. So let's try to write this program. So we have to use a counter to count the numbers from 1 to 8 in our given example. And we know that we can use range function to generate these numbers. So we say that for I in range 1 to n, do something. So we know that the variable I will take value from 1 up to 8. The number 9 will not be included in the range generated by this function. And similarly, we want to multiply each of these numbers by 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And therefore, we need another variable to hold values 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we use j to range from 1 to 5, and therefore the function we use is range 1 to 6. And now in each cell we have to just print the multiplication of I and j. So we can just say print I times j. So this will print I twice I, 3i, 4i up to 5i. Note that we have used a special thing called AND argument. We will discuss it a little bit using spider console. Okay, this is what will help us printing multiple values in same line or same row. Now once we are done with 5i, we have to print a new line, or we have to go on to the next line, and therefore we just use a plain print without any arguments to go to the next line. So this prints a new line character which moves the cursor or your printer to the next line. So this is the complete program. Let's look at this on the spider console. So on the spider console, I have the same program written in a script on the left side in the editor window. So let me just remove the end argument for some time. So I will comment it out. So if I run this program, this will also print the same values. However, we will notice that all the values that we print will be on one line in themselves. So each value is printed on a separate line. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the table of 1, then the table of 2, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, table of 3, 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, and so on. So what we want to do is, after a number is printed, we want to say don't print a new line, but print a space character, and that is what this end argument does. So end argument to print function, it says that instead of printing new line character, which is a default value, print simply the character that is provided. So now all the values for a particular row are printed by, separated by space. This is what is desired. We can use any character that we want. So suppose I am not interested in separating the values by space, but by a pound sign. In fact, in general, I can use any string. So let me say I want to separate them by two pound signs. I can do that. Now the program prints number separated by two pound signs. The last print on line 5, it does not really print any value, but it just prints the end marker, which by default is a new line character. So let's come back to our lecture. So let's have another problem. In this case, given this program, you have to guess what will be printed by the program. What is the output of this program? So whenever you are encountered such problems in which you have nested loops, it always helps to fix values for all outer loop and then see what happens in the innermost loops. So in this case, for example, when we start, the value of I will be 1 for the first iteration, and which means that the value for j will go from 1 up to 2 times 1, that is 2. So j takes value from 1 up to 2, and since the upper bound is not included, the value of j can only be 1, and we will print j, that is 1, followed by a space. So this is what the output in this case is. The first iteration of the outer loop results in only one iteration for the inner loop, the j loop, and in that case the value printed is simply 1. So after j loop is finished, we have to print a new line, and therefore the values corresponding to I equal to 2 will be printed on the next line. So when I is 2, j ranges from 2 up to 4. 4 is not included. The values that j takes are 2 and 3. And so this will be the second line of the output. For I equal to 3, we can see that j will go from 3 up to 6, not including 6. So the values are 3, 4, 5, and so on. This happens until I becomes 5, in which case we will print 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So you can see that if we take one iteration of outer loop and just go over inner loop, that simplifies understanding of the program. So to test your understanding, here is a quiz. Given this program where I ranges from 1 to 4 and j ranges from I up to 2 times I, you have to find out the result of the program, the output of the program. Note that there is no empty print at the end of j loop. So we will stop here, and I expect you to solve this quiz on your own using spider tool. A tuple in Python consists of a number of values separated by commas. So here is an example. A variable t is assigned a set of values separated by commas. So in particular, we have three values. First is a string intro to Python. Second is also a string Ameya Karkare. And third one is a number 101. These values are separated by commas. So what we get is a tuple that is assigned to the variable t. What can we do with the tuple? The first thing we can do is we can ask about individual values in the tuple, and very similar to string, the values in tuples are accessed using indices. So T0 corresponds to the value intro to Python, T1 corresponds to the value Ame Kar Kare, and T2 corresponds to the value 101 number. So unlike string, where the values at different indices were characters, in case of tuples, values can be complicated expressions. In tuples, values can be complicated themselves. So T itself can be printed by Python console. You can notice that when we print T, it shows us the different values stored in the tuple separated by comma and within round parentheses. And the type of variable T is, as expected, a tuple. Tuples can be empty, or they can also contain a single value. An empty tuple is created by putting square parentheses without any value. However, you have to be careful about creating singleton tuples. You have to put a single comma at the end of single value that you want to store in tuple. Without this comma, even if you put circular parentheses, even if you put round parentheses around the value, it will still be treated as a simple value, not a tuple. Tuples can be nested, which means if you have a tuple, you can make it part of another tuple. So here is an example. I have a tuple called course, which probably is storing the name of a course, the name of the instructor, and course number. And I have a tuple called student, which is storing name of a student, the roll number of the student, and the course the student is enrolled for. In this case, it's the Python course. Okay. If I want to print the student tuple, what I get is the name, the roll number, and complete details of the course for which this student is enrolled. The important thing to note is that course tuple is copied into the student tuple, which means even if I change the binding of tuple course later, it is not going to affect the student tuple. So maybe now I want to store the information about some other course in the variable course. However, the student tuple remains unchanged. Just like a string, tuples also allow having function called length to extract the length of a tuple. So for the given tuple, length of empty tuple is 0, length of singleton tuple is 1, length of course tuple is 3 because it contains 3 values, even though individual values themselves are non-simple values, they are strings. And then the length of student tuple also happens to be 3, and this is because even though student itself contains another tuple course, from the student perspective, this variable course is a single value, which happens to be of type tuple. So student contains 3 values, the name Prasanna, the roll number 34, and another tuple called course. Tuples also support concatenation, repetition, indexing, and slicing. So in that sense, they are very similar to string. So if I have two tuples, course 1 and course 2, I can concatenate them. The resulting value will be a tuple containing 6 values in this case. So we have Python Ame 101 followed by stats Adams 102. I can index a tuple, so I can ask third element in the tuple obtained by concatenating tuples course 1 and course 2, and the value will be the fourth value in the tuple. So once again, remember that the indexing starts at index 0. So the third index value is going to be stats. I can also take a slice of the concatenated tuple, which means I have to start at element with index 2, which is 101, and go all the way to the element at index 6, which is 1 before 7. So the semantics is very similar to how slicing works with strings. So we get the value 101 stats Adams 102. And finally, I can do repetition operation using a tuple and an integer value by putting this star operator. The resulting tuple is repetition of the original tuple, that is Python AMA 101 followed by Python AMA 101. So that's very similar to what we did with strings, except that the values can be other than characters. Thank you. Sequences in Python. In last few classes, we were looking at strings and tuples. Both these types are examples of sequence type in Python. They allow for indexing, slicing, concatenation, and repetition operation. Another operation which is applicable on sequences is called sequence unpacking operation. Unpacking allows us to get the components of the sequence into individual variables. So recall that we have multiple assignment in Python where you can have multiple left hand side being assigned from corresponding values at the right hand side. That is an example of unpacking operation. One of the restriction for unpacking operation is that the left hand side and right hand side must have equal length. We can also say that every value that is produced by right hand side should be assigned to a left hand side. So let's take our example of student tuple, which contains the name Prasanna, the roll number 34, and the course that this student is doing, which happens to be Python course by Amir, having course number 101. Now we can use sequence unpacking operation to get individual components of the student tuple. In other words, I can say name, comma, roll, comma, registered course on the left hand side is assigned the tuple student. The effect of this assignment is that individual component of student will get assigned to the corresponding variable on the left hand side. And therefore, if we print name after this assignment, we get a value Prasanna. If we print roll, we get 34. And if we print registered course, we get another tuple, that is Python AMA 101. Since strings are also sequences, we can also get individual characters in the string using unpacking operation. So if I say x1, x2, x3, x4 equal to the string AMEY AMA, the effect of this assignment will be x1 will get character A assigned, x2 will be assigned character M, and so on. So if I print these different variables, I get the components of the string. Now this may not be very useful unless you know the length of the string and you are willing to write those many variables yourself. Thank you. A list is an ordered sequence of values. In Python, it is written as a sequence of comma-separated values between square brackets. Recall that we can also have tuples as a sequence of comma-separated values, but in that case, you write it between round brackets or without any kind of brackets. In case of list, as well as in case of tuples, values can be of different types. However, unlike tuples, usually the list have items of all the same type. So here is an example of a list that contains integers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The type of list is type list. List is also a sequence type in Python, which means all the sequence operations are applicable to list. So here are some examples. Given a list of Fibonacci numbers, we can find out the length of the fib using len operator. We can index the list fib, and once again indexing starts at index 0. So fib of 3 will give us value 3, which is the fourth element in the list. We can slice a list, so we are asking for all the elements beyond index 3, which happen to be 3, 5, 8, 13, and so on. We can do concatenation of two lists. So maybe you want your Fibonacci number to start at start with value 0. So you can have another list which is 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, which is concatenation of list 0 with Fibonacci number list. You can repeat a list. So 3 times list 1, 1, 2 will be list 1, 1, 2 repeated thrice. So it's values 1, 1, 2 followed by 1, 1, 2 followed by 1, 1, 2. And you can unpack a list by using sufficient number of variables on the left hand side. So in this case, x, y, and z will get corresponding values of 1, 1, and 2. So lists are very, very important in Python programming. And there are many library functions which operate on list. So suppose you have a value x, and seq is a variable having a sequence value. It could be list, string, tuple, or some more sequences that we will see later. And I is an integer value. Then you can have different kind of operations on list. Assuming capital L is a list, you can append a value at the end of the list, or you can append more than one values or all values in a sequence SEQ. So it will add all the values contained in the sequence at the end of list L. You can insert an element X at an index I in the list. So it will add X at position having index I. You can remove an element by its value from list, or you can remove a value from a list by giving its position or index I. So this operation is called pop. You can remove the last element by not providing any index to the operation pop. You can ask for the index of a value x in a list. You can ask for number of repetitions of a value x in a list. You can sort a list. And you can even reverse the list, which means the sequence gets reversed. The sequence of values gets reversed. Okay. There are many, many more operations on list, but these are some important operations. One thing to note is the operations which are given in red modify the list itself. So when I say l.append x, the list L itself will contain a new element x, instead of returning a new list which contains x in addition to contents of x. So the red operations are changing the list itself, and you have to be careful when you are applying this operation because they are changing the existing list. So we will see examples of list in our assignments and example programs. Thank you.